In Focus on Newsmakers, my guest today is Stan Blitz. He is the author of the book Bandstand, The Untold Story, and that is going to be a play as well in February being performed in Havre. Stan, to begin with, tell me how you became interested in the history of American Bandstand.
I never bought the story, what happened to the true creator in 1956. I just didn't believe the newspaper, and I did some research. The newspaper was owned by Mr. Walter Annenberg, who was the chief financier for Ronald Reagan. And I did a lot of homework, and I said, one day I want to do a book, because I did not buy a man of the stature of Bob Horn being thrown out of Philadelphia like he was a common criminal. So I decided I wanted to meet the widow, and this is the first book ever, Fred, done about the true history of Bandstand before Dick Clark.
Okay, and so the gentleman, Bob Horn, was the original host of
the program. He was the creator.
The creator. And you have a photo, actually, of young people who are protesting because he was no longer on the program.
Well, it wasn't so much even he wasn't on the program. They protested. Then the management of WFIL-TV in Philadelphia offered Bob to be the music director for the new host, because they concocted things which the book will point out.
Okay.
And the reason what had happened in 1956, getting back to everything, was that they did not want Dick Clark to host the show. He was a novice. He didn't know anything about music. And they protested because Bob Horn created the show in 1952. And and Clark claimed in a number of his writings before I did Bandstand, The Untold Story, that Bob Horn was fired. He was not fired, Fred. He was offered to be Dick Clark's co-host and music director at WFIL. Now, Fred, if it's your show and then they take you down to be the music director, I wouldn't accept that either. So he resigned.
And
Dick Clark inherits the show. 1 year later, on August 5th, 1957, the show goes network as American Bandstand, and that's what the public knows.
Yeah, very interesting. Tell me about the reaction that you've gotten to the book.
Well, my biggest reaction, Fred, was at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Cleveland. But the thing I said, because I'm a purist, I said, the first thing I said when I spoke in Cleveland, and Terry Stewart is the executive director in Cleveland, I said, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame should not be here in Cleveland. It should be in Philadelphia, because if you ever saw a rock and roll picture with Buddy Holly, La Bamba, or any of the pictures, era pictures, they're not going to Cleveland. They're going to Philadelphia.
Mm.
And Terry Stewart gets up there and says, he's right, but we got the dinero, and that's the name of the game.
So I mentioned that next year in June, this will be a play in
yes.
Hobbs. How did you develop the story that you tell in the book into a play?
Well, I met this lady. Her name is Glenice Floyd. She's pretty popular in the Hobbs area. I was introduced to her by a mutual friend. And about 3 weeks ago, Fred, I went up to see one of her works that she's directed before her accident. It was called The Miracle Worker, The Story of Helen Keller. The lady's terrific. She wrote the script. We have 19 songs from the era. We have Tutti Frutti. People are going to be dancing in the aisles. We have the bunny hop. We have different things. And Glenice just took a liking to it. And we've been meeting for the last year and a half in this untimely accident, so it's going to be procrastinated in another couple months.
So it's really not just the story of the situation that occurred prior to Dick Clark taking over Bandstand, but you're also going to be really giving an opportunity to hear the music of that time.
Oh, it was crossover music.
Yeah.
It was Tony Bennett got one of his early starts and still performing. God bless him. What a great guy. He's 87 years old. And he got one of his starts in 1952 on Bob's show. Because of You was the song.
Mm.
It was crossover music. 1954 was probably one of the first rock and roll songs done by Bill Haley and the Comets called Rock Around the Clock. And they did a movie in that era with Sidney Poitier called Blackboard Jungle. and that was the theme song. But Presley came onto the scene about 55, and rock and roll with Ed Sullivan, Tommy Dorsey, he would go on to the show, and he changed the flow of music, like the Beatles did. Mm-hmm. And that's, they don't want an older man hosting a teenage dance show.
And this
is what the book really points out, because I spoke to the man who hired Dick Clark, and he was 87 years old at the time. And I said, if the show would have gone network with Bob Horn as the host compared to Dick Clark, would have been as successful. He laughed at me.
Mm.
Bob was a musician. The Bandstand Boogie, the theme song for American Bandstand, the lyrics were put to it by Barry Manilow in the late 80s. But it was originally an instrumental.
Mm.
And Bob Horn wrote it with Les and Larry Elgard in 1954.
Interesting. So tell me about the biggest challenges for you of taking a real-life story, the book that you wrote, and transitioning that into a play.
Well, we're setting the era in 1955. I did this in Farmington, New Mexico, with a group out of Raton, New Mexico, who have had the only number one hit ever in the state called Sugar Shack in 1963, recorded at the Norman Petty Studios in Clovis, New Mexico. So I did this theme in Farmington. I was the host. Unbelievable. People loved it. So I'm making the theme hot dogs, hamburgers, French fries, and Cokes. That's what the people used to eat. You're too young for it, but that's what they used to eat in that era.
Well, Stan, while American Bandstand is long gone, music shows are more popular than ever. What do you make of this explosion that we've had in music competition programs?
Choreography.
Mm-hmm.
The men and the women dancing, they didn't dance like that in the 50s, the bunny hop or the jitterbug or any. They made it very commercial. So people love the music, and it's theatrics.
Mm-hmm.
That's really is what has made it so popular. That's why Dancing with the Stars has such an audience.
Yeah.
And that's our era today.
Yeah. Well, and of course, on the music side, American Idol started the most recent craze with competition programs, but that has expanded dramatically. And in fact, the big story of this television series in the season, in the commercial side is on NBC, the show called The Voice, which they expanded from one night to two nights, and it has led to their ratings resurgence for the entire network for NBC. It went from last place to first place in the commercial side, largely on the wings of this program, The Voice. What do you make of that side of it, that we have?
It's new material. It's something new, even though it's old.
Mm-hmm.
And Disney has come up. I was watching the Disney Channel the other night, and I had to say, I'm going to watch this. They made 1953. The kids saying the things that they used to say, like daddy-o and things. And they're playing the music that you wouldn't think would be on the Disney Channel.
Mm-hmm.
It's a resurgence. It's like fashion. Fashion comes back every 10 years. If you hold on to your clothes long enough, it'll come back. That's the same thing with these shows.
It's just a cycle. Okay.
Yes, it's a cycle. Mm-hmm.
When did your love of music begin?
Well, my hero was Ricky Nelson.
Mm-hmm.
I just adored Ricky Nelson. I used to wear a brown sport jacket. My hair, I used to grease it back like Ricky Nelson. He was my hero. My love for that type of music was Ricky Nelson in rock and roll. And I love Sinatra. Sinatra personified to me class, which you don't have very much of this anymore. When you listen to Frank Sinatra, his phrasing, there was nothing like it. And Dean Martin, that's what I really enjoyed growing up in Philadelphia.
And you still get to play this music because you do a radio show on KSNM in Las Cruces. Tell me about that.
Well, the reason we do the show is I presented it to the management of the radio station. And I was listening to radio coming down here. I lived in Albuquerque for a long time. And I'm saying to myself, this is variety music that they're playing. They don't talk about the history. They don't say how a song evolved into a song like Ragdoll by the Four Seasons. And the Jersey Boys is the hottest item today, still. And the people love the music and the stories behind the music. Like, I just finished a book about Kenny Rogers, how he would do The Gambler and Lucille. There's a story behind everything. That's what I do on my show. I talk about the book and the history, because you watch shows or you listen, all they do today, except for possibly satellite music on satellite on XM radio, they don't do anything with the history. They'll play a song, and they play an artist like Marty Robbins, great artist. They play El Paso. Nobody ever heard of the kids never heard of Marty Robbins. They don't even know he was the artist behind El Paso. So I like to delve in. Like this week's coming show, I'm doing Fats Domino and Little Stevie Wonder, who dedicated on the Music Awards to Dick Clark, how he was instrumental in his career.
Tell me about the reaction that you get from listeners.
They love it. Mm-hmm. Fact that I just had my blood pressure taken in a nameless drugstore in this town. The woman says, I love your show. I can't go around. So they said, can you do Connie Francis? People don't do this today. It's like a novelty type of a thing, like the Everly Brothers. There's a whole genre of music that's not done anymore. Mm-hmm. And then you listen to music, and all due respect to the kids, a couple of the younger artists I like, I don't want to mention names, but I like them. They're okay. But back then, you could understand every word. If you listen to Tony Bennett sing San Francisco, you understand the lyrics. Today, I don't even understand it. It's a whole different world with the music.
It is a different world. Well, of course, the radio business is changing rapidly as well. With the digital revolution that we have now, where do you think that is going, Stan?
I think it's going to go, Fred, into satellite radio is going to become more effective with the people. But I still think people like to listen to the radio, having their cup of coffee, at least the demographics of the older people. Mm-hmm. The younger people, newspapers are almost obsolete with the younger generation. They read the news on the internet, but they're still going to be in major cities, newspapers like New York. There'll be the New York Times, the Washington Post, and papers like that. But in the smaller markets, the internet's taken over. Same thing in radio. I think the internet or satellite radio will take over. I've done interviews on the internet and doesn't work. But they tell me, I've had two major people tell me it's so great to do internet and no response.
Interesting.
As opposed to doing, I did an interview in Denver on Clear Channel with Peter Boyles. Unbelievable. 2 hours I did an interview. People called up, they bought books, they went crazy. Because people don't, they skirt the real thing. It's all rhetoric. Mm-hmm. I like to tell it like it is, because I lived the era. I did not dance on the show. I was too young. But I know the history. In fact, I got a call on Saturday. I'm having a guest on who was at when Stevie Wonder first started. He was called Little Stevie Wonder. And he was named by a Philadelphia disc jockey. And his family sold a piano to Fats Domino. And he danced on the original Bob Horn bandstand. I delve with people who were there. And there's no substitute for having people who lived the era.
Sure.
And being interviewed on, like, the national television, they just skirt the issue. Bandstand was the most popular afternoon variety show in the history of television. And the impact of Bandstand was not in Los Angeles, like the younger generation thinks. It was in Philadelphia. Mm. It was on 5 days a week.
Yeah.
5 days a week.
A huge phenomenon. Well, folks will learn more about this from reading the book, but also from your play that will begin in June in Hobbs. Any plans to take the play to other cities?
Absolutely. I'm going to take it all over the world. I'm going to have a manager, and we're going to, if Buddy Holly, who was killed in an airplane crash February 3rd, 1959, he's more popular posthumously than he was when he was alive. And there was never a book about Buddy Holly. Maria Elena, his widow, who's about ready to divorce and marry Peggy Sue, has been the recipient of all the royalties and whatever. Bandstand was far more popular. Buddy Holly was regional. Came out of Lubbock, Texas. He performed in Clovis, New Mexico. Bandstand is known all over the world. I see it, but it's a business, Fred. and I got to get paid for it. That's what it's all about. I'm not I have a very close friend who sold 5 million records, did a song called 1, 2, 3, never got a dime in royalties.
Mm.
But these kids, they were kids, these performers. They were not like people who knew, they didn't know the back end of the business. There's the front end performing and the back end getting paid. And I'm in the business of getting paid. I've had meetings in Hollywood, because Hollywood is controlled by 3 distribution companies. Mm. And if they don't want to pay, if Monica Lewinsky can get $12 million from a book about Bill Clinton, Bandstand is worth plenty. And that's how I look at it.
Well, Stan, it's been fascinating having you on the program. And we wish you good luck with the book.
Could I give one more time to purchase the book?
We wish you good luck with the book and with the play as well. And we know that folks will look for it. Thank you so much for being here.
Okay, my pleasure, Fred.
Thank you.